Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The opening session will begin in 5 minutes. As a courtesy to our speakers as well as the attendees, please silence your cell phones. Your attention, please. The opening session is about to begin. Please take your seats and silence your cell phones. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the president of the Chest Foundation, Dr. Lisa Moores.
Good morning. I am so excited to be here in this wonderful city of San Antonio. I'm especially happy to be able to sport my chest denim. I hope you will all support our Denim Days today in support of the foundation. I also have to call out my amazing board of trustees who gave me the gift of these boots as we started the meeting. I think you'll all agree they're pretty awesome. I am really grateful for the opportunity I have had to serve as the president of the foundation over the past year. It's been an amazing year. We have a lot to be proud of, a lot to be excited about. And I'd like to start just for a moment by thanking people, thanking all of you for your support of the foundation, thanking the leadership, the trustees, and perhaps most importantly, our amazing staff for the foundation. Without this collective energy and vision and unwavering belief in our mission of championing lung health, we would not be the flourishing foundation that we are today. So first, I'd like to call on those board of trustees again. They're an amazing group. And along with them, we would like to thank a few people. So again, if you'll indulge me. First, we'd like to thank Sue Reinbold, our executive director. Sue has an amazing amount of passion and dedication. And in everything she does, you can sense her belief in the foundation and in what we do. And through her leadership, we have turned the foundation around from a loss center to one that completed last fiscal year more than $1 million in the black. So, Sue, words alone cannot express our appreciation, but I had to at least try. Thank you, Sue. Now, of course, all great leaders surround themselves with a good team, and Sue has an amazing team working with her. And I'd like to thank Rudy Anderson, Angela Perillo, Andrew Gillen, Mariana Pantaline, and Chloe Daniels. They are so fun to work with, and you can tell that they really enjoy what they do, and they have an amazing work ethic. You all really do champion lung health for us, so thank you. I would be remiss if I didn't recognize the presidential lineage, my co-Ps. So Mike Nelson for his leadership and mentorship as I came up through these ranks. Doreen Adrizzo-Harris, who will be taking over the reins as the foundation president in just a few moments. And Ed Diamond, who will be following her. And again, the entire board of trustees. And last, but certainly not least, I'd actually like to recognize the presidents, the Board of Regents, the leadership of the college as well, particularly John Studder. John, thank you for including the foundation in everything you do. We truly are one chest now, and being able to work together as boards has helped us to really focus on our mission and move the foundation forward. So the foundation has just completed a year in which we've raised nearly $3 million. Demonstrating the increased financial stability of our foundation. And as you will soon hear, we've been able to provide over $500,000 in clinical research grants and community service grants. In fact, as I read through these community service grants, they really touched me. I think you're gonna agree that these are some amazing projects, and you're gonna hear about them in just a few moments. And we've been good stewards with the money that we've been raising, and we've been able to increase the number of clinical research grants that we've been giving. And in this year alone, we had a brand new award in severe asthma, and we were able to give multiple grants in COPD and IPF. And as the co-chair of the awards committee, I can tell you that the quality of the submissions of our clinical research grants has gone up significantly, and it's become harder and harder to choose the winners. So again, when you hear these projects today in just a few moments, I think you're gonna join me in being truly amazed at the work that we're going to do. And I'm confident that these projects are going to lead to important improvements in patient outcomes. A couple of the other things that the foundation has been able to do is through donations from you all, donations from key leaders, our networks challenge, we've been able to support almost 80 travel and diversity grants to bring young and upcoming leaders of the college to this meeting today. We continue to focus on important patient-facing education. We've had multiple new patient education guides, in particular, one in lung transplant that is coming out soon. We've worked on shared decision-making tools that you can use with your patients, and we've come out with new guides that allow patients to manage their disease along with us. We've had several disease awareness campaigns. We completed one in sarcoidosis, one in asthma over the summer, and we're planning one in lung cancer before the end of the year. One of the newest accomplishments that I'm especially proud of is the foundation's effort to expand and partner with the Women and Pulmonary Initiative. I think it's important that we address gaps in gender issues in medicine, both in patients and patient care, but also for women looking for advancements in academic leadership and other leadership positions. So I hope many of you were able to attend the Women in Pulmonary Luncheon yesterday and that you found that helpful, and we look forward to continuing that partnership. One of the other things that I think is really important to share with you is perhaps one of the most important, advancements over the last year. And that is that the Chest Foundation, your foundation, has been approved as a member of the combined federal campaign. For those of you that work in the federal government, you know that the CFC is the only authorized way to solicit donations from federal employees in the workplace. And as an improved organization, we will be able to be out there in these campaigns, sharing our word. And as a federal employee myself, I think this is going to be a significant way for us to reach more potential donors. So I am very, very excited to be able to share that with you. Now, of course, accomplishments like these don't happen by magic, and we would not be here without all of you and the support from all of you. And I wanted to just address one thing, because I think there are certainly some people in the audience today, perhaps even some of our young travel grant awardees, are saying, I'm really not at a point in my career where I can significantly donate to the foundation. But I want to bring you back to what true philanthropy is. And that really is just an active effort to promote human welfare. And so while that may include monetary gifts, it also can be a gift of your time or your creative energy and ideas. So I really encourage all of you to drop by the donor lounge, meet with me or any of the foundation staff or other leaders, and talk to us about how you can engage in philanthropy. In the words of the great tennis star Arthur Ashe, start where you are, do what you can, use what you have. So as I conclude, I would like to challenge all of you to become champions of lung health. Now, I started this monologue by acknowledging that we're in the wonderful city of San Antonio. And last night, the foundation was able to experience a wonderful reception in the beautiful Gunther Pavilion of the Western Art Museum. And we were honored to have two very special guests. We had the San Antonio Spurs head coach, Greg Popovich, and his daughter, Jill. Now, tragically, they lost their wife, their mother, Erin, to lung disease this past spring. And they are passionate about partnering with us, and in fact challenged us to raise $1 million in donations over the next year to further our efforts in improving lung health. And if we are successful, Coach Pop and Jill will match this donation with $1 million from them. So again, please, please visit the Donor Lounge before you leave this wonderful city. Donate to the foundation and the many programs that will be created in the memory of Erin Popovich and in honor of her wonderful family. In fact, let's find a way to raise this money before we even leave town. It's now my privilege to welcome Dr. Doreen Adrizzo-Harris, Foundation President-elect, to the stage. Dr. Adrizzo-Harris and I co-chair the Foundation Awards Committee, and we're pleased to recognize this year's grant winners.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome. I'm going to start by giving out the first grant in non-tuberculous mycobacterial disease, and I'd like to say I'm very honored to give this grant since I'm giving it to one of my fellows. I had nothing to do with the voting, but I'm very, very proud that he's receiving it. So this is a grant which is supported by InsMed, and it's awarded to Dr. Imran Suleiman in New York City for his project, Lower Airway Microbiota Signatures Associated with Impaired Immune Response in Non-Tuberculous Mycobacterium. This is our new grant in severe asthma, which was supported by AstraZeneca. It's awarded to Dr. Anna Vollmeren from the University of Chicago for her project, a randomized clinical trial evaluating the effectiveness of virtual teach-to-goal education versus brief intervention for children with severe asthma. The CHESS Foundation Research Grant in Pulmonary Fibrosis is supported by a scientific advancement agreement from Boehringer Ingelheim Pharmaceuticals and by a grant from Genentech. So we were able to award two grants this year. The first goes to Dr. Ayordeji Degonseyi from the University of Chicago. And she is awarded for her project on the impact of telomere length on pulmonary fibrosis clusters across diverse racial cohorts. I'm so sorry about that. I was just concentrating on your beautiful name. The second award goes to Dr. Justin Oldham, wow, that was much easier, from the University of California at Davis for his project, Plasma Biomarkers to Predict Outcomes and Treatment Response in Patients with Pulmonary Fibrosis. This year's CHESS Foundation Research Grant in Women's Lung Health is supported by the CHESS Foundation and is awarded to Dr. Margaret Bublitz of the Miriam Hospital in Providence, Rhode Island. And her project is Sex as a Predictor of Sleep Disordered Breathing and Its Consequences in Pregnancy. The CHESS Foundation Research Grant in Chronic Obstructive Pulmonary Disease is supported by an independent educational grant from AstraZeneca Pharmaceuticals and by an independent medical education grant from Sunovion Pharmaceuticals. It's awarded to two individuals this year. The first is Dr. Jacob Brenner from the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia for his project, Ambulatory Cure-Os Ventilation for Relief of Exertional Dyspnea in Severe COPD Patients. The second grant award goes to Dr. William Zhang from New York Presbyterian Weill Cornell Medicine in New York City for his project, Pulmonary Iron Overload as a Novel COPD Endotype. Okay, we've got a few more to go. The Chest Foundation Research Grant in Venous Thromboembolism, supported in full by the Chest Foundation, is awarded to Dr. Timothy Morris from the University of California, San Diego, for his project, Long-Term Follow-Up of Acute Pulmonary Embolism. The Chest Foundation Research Grant in Cystic Fibrosis, supported by a charitable donation from Vertex Pharmaceuticals Incorporated, is awarded to Dr. Don Sanders of the Indiana University School of Medicine for his project, Whole Genome Shotgun Sequencing of Oropharyngeal Swabs in Infants with Cystic Fibrosis. The Chest Foundation Research Grant in Pulmonary Arterial Hypertension, supported in full by the Chest Foundation, goes to Dr. Monica Mukherjee from Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine for the project, Exercise Provocation in the Non-Invasive Detection of Occult Right Ventricular Dysfunction and Emerging Pulmonary Hypertension in Patients with Systemic Sclerosis. The Chest Foundation Research Grant in Lung Cancer, supported in full by the Chest Foundation, is awarded to Dr. Samira Sojayi from Virginia Commonwealth University in Richmond, Virginia, for her project, Extracellular Vesicle miRNA as a Biomarker in Malignant Pleural Effusion. The Eli Lilly and Company Distinguished Scholar in Critical Care Medicine, an award supported by Eli Lilly and Company, is presented to Dr. Robert Heise from the University of Michigan for his project, The Use of Electrical Impedance Tomography to Assess Mechanical Ventilation in Acute Respiratory Distress Syndrome. Thank you very much to all the grant winners. We're very, very proud of you. And now, here to present the 2018 Community Service Grant Awards are the co-chairs of the Chest Foundation's Community Service Work Group, Dr. Neil Friedman and Dr. Bob DeMarco.
Thank you, Doreen. As co-chairs of the Chest Foundation, Community Foundation Service Work Group, it's an honor for Neil and me to be here to announce this year's winners. These awards are given to nonprofit and non-governmental organizations throughout the world where Chest members volunteer their time and medical expertise to help those most in need. This year, we are awarding three Chest Foundation Community Service Grants honoring D. Robert McCaffrey, MD, Master, FCCP, supported in full by your Chest Foundation. This first award goes to Ms. Pamela Garrett of Gwinnett Medical Center in Lawrenceville, Georgia, for the project Breathe Better Gwinnett. This is a multidisciplinary community event that will establish a foundation for an ongoing community initiative to promote lung health.
The second Chest Foundation Community Service Grant honoring D. Robert McCaffrey is awarded to Dr. Deborah Haish from Columbia University Medical Center in New York City for the Project East African Training Initiative in Pulmonary and Critical Care Medicine, which provides procedural training for fellows and faculty in Ethiopia. Dr. Haish, unfortunately, is unable to join us today. Accepting this award on her behalf is Dr. David Steiger. The final grant award goes to Dr. Philip Sheridan of North Shore University Health System in Winnetka, Illinois, for the project Home Environment Education for Children with Asthma that provides ongoing medical care to low-income children with asthma and severe allergies using mobile clinics in Chicago.
So let's give them one more round of applause. Congratulations to all our grant winners. In addition to those that we just recognized, the Chest Foundation was able to give out 58 additional travel grants awarded for career and diversity grants for our some of our most junior faculty and fellows. I'd like to just take a moment to recognize and congratulate them as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Chest President, Dr. John Studdard.
Good morning, y'all. It's great to be back again this morning. Before I get started, I got my denim on to support the incredible work of the foundation, but I need to pay somebody $20. Kim French is down there. I'll get it to Kim. I'll give it to you right after the meeting. They mentioned something about putting it in dip jars, but again, I'm from Mississippi, and our definition of a dip jar, I'm not really quite sure what to do with that, but so I'm just going to give it to a lovely lady and my friend Kim French. Congratulations once again to all of the attendees and awardees that were recognized here today. You know, now we've reached the time where I officially transfer stewardship of the college and the symbols of the office of president to Dr. Clayton Cole. You know, it's really been my privilege and an honor to serve this group as your 80th president. Honestly, I really don't know where the last year went. It's been a great year, and I have every confidence that transferring the presidency to Clay, I'm leaving y'all in great hands. Clay, please join me on stage. I'm going to pause just a second and tell y'all that many of y'all might not know, Clay has a background in aeronautics and flight. Frequently this year when we've gone to meetings and Clay has introduced himself in meetings with groups of folks, he's introduced himself as my wingman. Since my knowledge of wingmen mainly come from watching Maverick and Goose and Top Gun, I thought I would Google, I actually can do that, and learn more about wingmen. One article characterized a great wingman as possessing the following attributes. Be a good follower. Back up, not lead, no matter how much wants to. Clay's pretty good at that. Keep your communications to a minimum. Join up and shut up. Up until the last few weeks, I thought Clay was pretty good at that. But don't cause more problems. Clay is generally great at that. And coming behind Gerard Silvestri and John Studdard, I think he probably says, wow, way too many problems. but he'll let Silvestri and I handle that. Execute the mission, brief the flight, fly the brief. Clay's all over that. Be a safety observer, keeping the lead out of trouble. Clay has done a pretty good job of that because he's clearly had his hands full. Clay, thanks for being a great wingman, doing all of this and more. Thanks for your incredible leadership and your supportive leadership of me. Your energy and passion that you bring with you and all that you do will serve you well as you guide this organization forward. Your focus and dedication to improving patient care will provide an example for all of us to follow. It is my great pleasure to welcome, as the 81st president of the American College of Chest Physicians, Dr. Clay Coe. John Silvestri again. Gerard broke it, and he got it hung around his neck. Clay, congratulations.
Thanks, John. Wow. This thing is pretty heavy. So first presidential decision, avoid occupational injury. I'm just gonna take a moment to set this thing down, but I'll cherish this moment forever. So hang on. All right, well, welcome. What a great crowd today. I feel a little underdressed, or overdressed, I should say, with all this denim in the crowd, but you know, crowds are pretty smart, and this morning I'd like to share with you some thoughts about crowds and their collective wisdom. In particular, why it's important that we as CHEST leadership remain good listeners, and why sometimes that can be hard. And how through improved listening and two-way communication with our membership, we can leverage this wisdom. You see, harnessing that collective intelligence is critical to defining our organization as the premier association for pulmonary, critical care, and sleep medicine professionals. So I want to start with a story. So one day in the fall of 1906, Francis Galton, who was a British scientist and actually a cousin of Charles Darwin, left his home in Plymouth, England, and headed out to a country fair. Now, he was 85 years old at the time, but still brimming with curiosity that won him fame and admiration for the work he had done in statistics and the science of heredity. Now, on that particular day, what Galton was curious about was livestock. Now, his destination was the annual West of England Fat Stock and Poultry Exhibition, a regional event where local farmers and townspeople congregated to judge the quality of each other's cattle, sheep, pigs, and horses. Now, why would a scientist like Galton want to be crawling around livestock pens, especially at his age? Well, there was some logic to this. Galton was obsessed with two things: the measurement of physical and mental qualities, and breeding. And what, after all, is a livestock show than a big showcase of the effects of good and bad breeding? So Galton had done a variety of experiments over the years, and his findings left him with little faith in the intelligence of the average person. Now, Galton was essentially an elitist who felt that breeding mattered because only a very few people had the characteristics necessary to keep societies healthy and strong, and that power and control should stay in the hands of the select and well-read few. In fact, he'd spent a majority of his career trying to measure those characteristics in order to prove that the vast majority of people didn't have those traits. So as he meandered through the fair, he came across a weight judging competition in which the fairgoers could guess what the weight of an ox would be after it was slaughtered and dressed. So for 6 pence, you could buy a stamped and numbered ticket where you filled in your name and placed your estimate. The best guessers would receive prizes, and a total of 800 people approximately tried their luck. Now, this was a diverse group. Many were knowledgeable, such as butchers and farmers, who were presumably expert in knowing livestock. But quite a few had little, if any, knowledge or insights into the ins or outs of cattle. They just wanted to take a stab at getting that prize. You know, Galton wrote in the scientific journal Nature, the average competitor was probably as well fitted for making a just estimate of the dressed weight of an ox as the average voter is of judging the merits of most political issues upon which he votes. I guess some things never change. Galton was interested in finding out what the average voter was capable of because he was convinced that the average voter was capable of very little. So he turned the weight judging competition into an experiment. When the contest was over and the prizes had been awarded, Galton borrowed the tickets from the organizers and ran a series of statistical tests on them. He arranged the data from the least to the greatest, and he tried to plot them in a bell curve, and then he calculated the mean of the group's guesses. Now, that number represented what you could say was the sort of collective wisdom of the Plymouth crowd. Now, if the crowd was a single person, the mean represented what the crowd would have guessed the ox weighed. Now, Galton probably figured that the average guess of the group was going to be well off the mark. I mean, mix a few very wise people with a few mediocre people and a whole bunch of dumb people, and it would seem to Galton that you'd get a dumb answer. But you know, Galton was wrong. Now, the crowd had guessed that the ox, after it had been slaughtered and dressed, would weigh 1,197 pounds. And after it had actually been slaughtered and dressed, the ox weighed 1,198 pounds. In other words, the crowd's judgment was essentially perfect. So maybe breeding wasn't important after all. And Galton later wrote, "The results seem more credible to the trustworthiness of a democratic judgment than what might be expected." And that was, to say the least, an understatement. What Galton stumbled upon that day in Plymouth, more than 100 years ago, was the simple but powerful truth that under the right circumstances, groups are remarkably intelligent and often smarter than the smartest people in them. Now, groups do not necessarily need to be dominated by the absolute experts in order to be smart. In fact, even if most of the people within a group are not exceptionally informed or up to speed, the group can still reach a collectively wise decision. Now, this is a good thing, because human beings are not perfectly designed decision makers. So think about it. We generally have less information than what we'd like. We have limited foresight into the future. Most of us lack the ability and probably the desire to make sophisticated cost-benefit calculations for everything we do. Instead of insisting we make the absolute best data-driven decision, we'll often accept what seems just sort of good enough, and we often let emotion affect our judgments. But despite all our faults, when our imperfect judgments are aggregated in the right way, our collective intelligence is often excellent. This collective wisdom is what best-selling author James Sirwickley called the wisdom of crowds. Now, what's interesting about the wisdom of crowds and what Sirwickley tells us is that although its effects are all around us, it can be easy to miss. And even when it's seen, it can be hard to accept. That's because most of us, whether we're voters or investors or consumers or managers, believe that knowledge is concentrated in a very few brains who we call the experts. We assume that the key to making good decisions is finding that one right person who's the expert in a specific topic who will have the right answer. You know, we need to stop hunting for that one elusive expert and instead ask the crowd, which includes the experts, as well as everyone else. Chances are, the crowd knows. If you put together a large enough and diverse enough group of people and ask them to make decisions affecting matters of general interest, those groups' decisions, over time, will be intellectually superior to the isolated individual, no matter how smart or informed the one expert is. Now, don't get me wrong, not all crowds are wise. Examples of lynch mobs or trolling on the internet or investors in a market bubble involve crowds that make very poor or biased judgments. So How do we leverage the collective intelligence of the crowds in our professional lives? That is, what crowds am I talking about? Well, take a look around. At this meeting alone, we'll have more than 5,000 attendees, experts in all areas of pulmonary, critical care, and sleep medicine are right here, from interstitial lung disease to pulmonary vascular disease, from asthma and COPD to complex sleep disorders, from sepsis and heart failure to occupational and environmental lung disease. You know, crowds come in all sorts, and CHEST is listening to our crowd. The key for you as our membership is don't retreat into the crowd, but instead use your voice and be part of our crowd. Let's think about the crowds in our individual lives. Take, for instance, your family. Yeah, even that input you get from your spouse or significant other, even when you don't want to receive it, or the people in your workplace, or your patients, or even input from your places of worship. They often know the answers, and frankly, they deserve your attention. You know, I want to take a moment to recognize some very important crowds in my life. In terms of family, I have, well, let's just say, a very large crowd. My incredible wife, Cammy, is here this morning with our seven wonderful children, two son-in-laws, and you know, I really should take the time to get to know all their names. And joining them are my parents, Larry and LaVon. This crowd has been truly supportive. They've politely kicked my shins under the table when I needed it and reminded me of the manners I've conveniently forgotten. They have stood by me through life's ups and downs and taught me so much more than I've taught them. You guys, I love and appreciate you very much, and it's so great to have you here today. Another extremely important crowd in my life is made up of my colleagues and friends from Mayo Clinic. These men and women make up an incredible collective wisdom that has grounded me personally in so many ways. You know, I work in a true team environment. Whether in research or teaching or evaluating people in the clinic, despite the frenetic pace of modern day medicine fraught with coldness and burnout, this crowd is gentle with the patients and gentle with each other. You know, I've enjoyed the blessings of outstanding mentorship and incredibly collegial colleagues who have supported me unconditionally. And one of those individuals I'd like to mention is Dr. Dick Hickman, who first hired me at Mayo Clinic. He's an emeritus chair of the Division of Preventive, Occupational, and Aerospace Medicine. And he trusted that my combined training in pulmonary medicine with that of occupational and aerospace medicine would help answer a need in the field. Without his mentorship, I'm sure I would have never had the opportunities given to me in my career. I'd like to personally thank him for being here today with his wife, Catherine. For your trust and foresight, Dick, I will be forever grateful. I would be remiss if I did not specifically mention and thank prior ACC presidents Ed Rosenau and Udaya Prakash, who are emeritus professors at Mayo Clinic as well, and who steered me to pursue leadership opportunities in this great organization. They have been mentors in the clinic and, perhaps more importantly, mentors in life. Thanks to all of you at Mayo. Another amazing crowd deserving recognition this morning are those of you here associated with the American College of Chest Physicians as both leadership and as faculty. With so much collective wisdom, energy, enthusiasm for innovation, research into the science of learning, we're working together to improve care for patients in so many different ways. In particular, I'd like to recognize our incredible educators. Those in the audience who received the Distinguished Chest Educator designation this year, please stand and be recognized. Thank you. These individuals deserve our sincere appreciation. They have spent countless hours offering their collective wisdom to design and organize chess courses and programs and sharing their expertise as faculty. This coming year, we plan to leverage those amazing talents again and listen to your ideas in order to propel our organization forward. The wisdom of our crowd at CHEST knows absolutely no bounds. Even in this meeting here in San Antonio, you're going to hear about efforts to pilot virtual crowdsourcing during the meeting to create an actual live session this week that addresses what you want to hear now rather than topics submitted months ago. Speaking of crowds, I want you to stick around for the crowd at CHEST Challenge tomorrow night, and don't forget to try out our simulation courses and check out serious gaming modules located in the corridors. They're a lot of fun, and we actually might learn something together. It's important to underscore the fact that CHEST is much bigger and collectively wiser than any one person. We will continue to ask for diversity of expertise and opinions by doubling down on our efforts already started to encourage more participation throughout CHEST in networks, committees, and courses from individuals of varying backgrounds, clinical expertise, cultures, and perspectives. Together, we'll create a culture of innovation that underscores the development of new programs that move our mission forward more effectively. We at CHEST embrace new ideas and will be introducing fun ways for our membership to thrive in the innovation environment. Things such as rolling out competitions for our entrepreneurs, developing focus groups from thought leaders both inside and outside of CHEST, and leveraging new concepts in information technology to keep you abreast of those advancements. Let's work together to extinguish the death by PowerPoint lectures that always seem to dominate medical meetings throughout the world, and instead continue to introduce novel methods for curricular design and delivery. You know, we'll put those ideas to work together through improved communications with our membership, rather than simply creating strategy sitting at a boardroom table. CHEST will use novel technologies to connect and converse with you wherever you are, domestic and international, in person and virtual, academic or private practices, with all members of the healthcare team, physicians, respiratory therapists, nurses, advanced practice providers, pharmacists, even our colleagues within industry. So my challenge to you is this. Think about the proverbial crowds where you spend time. Be thankful for the relationships that you have in each of these groups, and be a leader for positive change every day, whether that be as a leader in team rounds or a provider who takes that little extra time to teach a patient or their family about the care you're providing, or a faculty member who ensures that they keep their materials up to date and delivered in fresh, new, and exciting ways. Or as an innovator who's unafraid to challenge the status quo, and doing so at the risk of possible skepticism or even failure. Bringing those collective ideas forward does indeed make all of us wiser and ultimately improves the care of our patients. And after all, that's why we're here. It is an absolute honor to serve membership this year as president, but it is my duty to be a great listener and utilize the input of our crowd within CHEST to make our organization even better. Thank you very much. For our next occupational injury, before the introduction of our keynote speaker, I'd like to take a moment to recognize Dr. John Studdard, who is completing an absolutely amazing year as president. John, please join me on the stage. John, your guidance, your incredible passion, and your ability to literally light up a crowd in a room has been so valuable to me over the past year. You know, the accomplishments of our organization under your leadership in a variety of roles, not only for your presidency, but over more than 20 years, has been absolutely tremendous, and your dedication and loyalty to CHEST is evident to all who know you. And not only are you a Mayo alumnus, but you are truly a Southern gentleman who deeply cares about the people in your life and those who you serve. On behalf of the American College of Chest Physicians, please accept this small token of gratitude. And y'all give John a big round of applause.
Awesome.
I better shoot carefully.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you, Clay, and thanks all of y'all. And now I'd like to introduce today's keynote speaker. You know, each generation and each member of a medical team communicates differently. Understanding those differences and feeling like an equal part of the team is very important. How information is conveyed to patients and medical team members of any age affects how they perceive given information and the level of comfort that is felt by each party. Finding ways to bridge obvious gaps between generations is a key component to making any team work efficiently. Today's speaker, Scott Zimmer, works with generational theory and works to drive home points and make these ideas more relatable. He recognizes that generations clash in every single industry and knows that this topic isn't foreign to anyone. Please help me now as we welcome our speaker, Scott Zimmer.
Good morning. I haven't even done anything yet. Thank you. I have to say, thank you so much for that introduction. One of the best things about my job, being somebody who researches and speaks on the topic of generations in the workplace or in the marketplace, has got to be that wherever I'm speaking and whoever I'm speaking to, this is a topic that everyone can relate to, because at one point or another, I feel we've all had a moment where we failed to connect with another generation. We failed to get on the same page. Do me a favor. I want to create a safe space right now, even though there's about 1,000 or so of us in here. But do me a favor. Raise your hand if at any point in your life you've ever uttered the phrase, "Ugh, kids today." See, again, safe space. Yep, lights up. There's a lot of you. All right. Let's flip it. How many of you at one point in your life have said something to the effect of, "Ugh, old people"? There you go. Right there, that's a generational clash. What works for communicating with, engaging, motivating one generation doesn't always work with another. In fact, sometimes it's the very thing that just turns another generation off. And too often when that happens, right away we go to a negative place. We stereotype, we hone in on our differences, we get frustrated, rather than try and find ways to bring our different generational talents and perspectives to the table to help get the job done. And as leaders, that's the challenge, to create an environment where everyone feels valued, respected, and understood. And the thing I've learned over the last 5-6 years that I've been with Bridgeworks speaking on this topic, these generational clashes we experience in our careers, they don't start when our careers start. Oftentimes, these generational clashes start in our very own home. And I found a clip that I thought illustrated that perfectly. Take a look at this.
I want to use all caps to get across how angry I am, but it takes forever to press shift before each letter.
Why don't you just put on the caps lock?
You can do that?
Oh, Jay, just double click here.
Didn't work.
Well, that's because you didn't double click. You just clicked twice.
How's the difference?
Double click. See?
It's exactly what I did. Double click.
No, you're still just clicking twice. Listen to me. Double click, not double click.
I'm not an idiot. Double click!
You can't possibly think that's the same thing.
It's the exact same thing!
Double click!
Double click!
Oh, what the? It's the first time I've ever used the F word.
A couple weeks ago, I showed that clip, and I actually had a woman come up to me afterwards. She was a baby boomer, and she goes, "Thank you for showing that clip, because I had no idea that's how you did that." And I felt really good. I'm like, it just made me feel accomplished. Like, she got something out of the presentation right away, and that made me feel good. All right, let's take it back. I want to figure out who's in the room and talk a little bit about who these different generations are. At Bridgeworks, we look at five distinct generations today. The first one being the traditionalist generation, that generation born prior to 1946. Now, this generation goes by a lot of different names. They're sometimes known as the GI generation, the silent generation. If you've ever heard of Tom Brokaw's book, The Greatest Generation, this is who he's talking about. It's that World War II era, Great Depression era, born prior to 1946. Now, just out of curiosity, clap your hands nice and loud if I have any traditionalists in here today. We got a few. That's great. That's a pretty fair representation, because I will say today in the workplace across the United States, 2% of the workplace is traditionalist. Many have since retired. But I will say, this is a generation I love talking about, because this is the generation that helped build and grow and establish so many of the different industries we work for and who we work with today, including what you do. You see their influence all around you, even if you don't see them in the halls every single day. Next, we got the baby boomer generation, born between 1946 and 1964. Baby boomers, do me a favor, make some noise, clap your hands, where are you guys at? Very nice. You got your name from the fact that you were part of the post-war baby boom, the most populous generation we had seen up until that point. Especially compared to my generation. I am a proud Gen Xer. Gen Xers, we peaked at 60 million in the US, born between 65 and 79. Fellow Xers, Shomont's done, where you at? Nice. I love that, nobody talks about Xers. You know, everyone's talking about boomers and work ethic and leaving a legacy and millennials and disruption and innovation. Nobody's talking about us. We are the middle child. We are the Jan Brady of the generations. I'm telling you. Millennials. 1980 to 1995, you guys peaked at 75 million here in the U.S. Millennials, don't be shy. Where are you at? I like that. A lot of times, especially at the more corporate events that I do, the millennials are very timid about that, because I think they're worried it's going to be an hour-long rant about their generation, so it's a very, like, timid clap, and they kind of sink in their seat. But it is not going to be a rant about you guys, I promise. And there's good news. You are not the new kids on the block anymore. Gen Z is officially entering the workplace, born between 1996 and 2010. Gen Z, do we have any of you in here today? All right, there you go. That is the future right there. And just as you're still scratching your head about millennials, guess what? As they walk through the door, they grew up in a completely different world and have a whole different way of learning and approaching work that you get to learn all over again. So, lucky us. By the way, if you were looking at that and you were thinking, what happens if you're someone smack dab in the middle? What happens if you got one foot in one generation and one foot in the other? You're what we call a cusper. Now, it's a very technical term, I know, but in our book, we have a chapter called Cusper the Friendly Ghost, and it talks about those people. Thank you. I actually didn't write that, but I will pass that on. Cuspers often feel a little left out of the conversation we're having right now because they don't feel that strong generational pull or loyalty to one generation or another, because honestly, it's hard to do that if you don't even know which box to check on the form. If you're born in late 79 or early 1980 or in 1965, it's hard to know where you go. At the end of the day, don't worry so much about the generational label. That has less to do with it. Cuspers play a big part in what we're talking about today. We're talking about effective generational communication. Colleagues, patients, doesn't matter. Cuspers are great at so many things. They have a generational lens that, I like to call them generationally bilingual. I know that's not an actual thing, but just go with it. Because they're great at mediating, translating, resolving conflicts. If you've ever been at work and somebody says, if you're a cusper, you might have to be the person who sometimes says, hey Bob, what Jessica meant earlier in the meeting when she said that to you was this. So she wasn't trying to be offensive. So know that if you are a cusper, you play a big part in what we're talking about here today. But really, at the end of the day, and this is what made me fall in love with this topic, generational theory, the study of generations, It has nothing to do with your birth date or how old you are or neatly putting people in a box. Generational theory is really all about the events and the conditions that we share during our formative years. So I want you to think about that for a minute. Your formative years, those are roughly your teenage years, your adolescent years, that period in your life when you were going through brain development. You know, your head's kind of wet cement. You're starting to think and act for yourself, make up your own mind, formulate your own opinion on things. What's going on in the world at that time has a profound and lasting impact on how we see the world. It shapes everything from our traits, our values, our sense of right and wrong, social justice, work ethic. All of that really starts to form during those formative years. So today, I don't just want to talk about the what, like what are these different generational approaches to work? I want to talk about the why. Why do they exist? Because once we have a better understanding of the why, then we can really start to look at how can we all work to bridge these gaps that we face every day? Because it's not about right or wrong, better or worse. It's about understanding that all of us are bringing something different and valuable to the table. So when you think about your formative years, I'd be willing to bet, if I were to ask you right now, what is your all-time favorite movie? What is your all-time favorite band, favorite song? What was the funniest era of Saturday Night Live? Chances are, whatever answer's in your head right now probably dates back to your formative years. When was the last time MTV was good? Chances are, that's gonna date back to your formative years. What's going on in the world of technology, pop culture, what's in the news, shapes us so much. If you grew up during an era when the transistor radio was the hot new technology, your approach to technology in the workplace is going to be different than somebody who came up during the era of the iPhone. And you can look at it this way too. I want to give you an example. Baby boomers. Let's take NASA for example. When you think of NASA and you think of your formative years, what was that big moment that everybody watched? The moon landing. By a show of hands, how many of you saw the moon landing when it happened in 1969? That's amazing. I talk to boomers all the time and ask them, what was that like? And the stories I hear, I mean, I read about it, but I wasn't there. And so to hear stories firsthand about gathering on the couch and how late at night it was and how they were woke up to come downstairs and watch it because it was such a big deal. To have grandma and grandpa watch this. You know, grandma and grandpa who didn't grew up without a car, and now they're watching a man walk on the moon. There was so much pride and excitement and patriotism that went along with it. The idea that we won the space race, we beat Russia, there was a man on the moon. But then I think, man, Xers, when we think back to our formative years, what's our go-to memory of NASA? The Challenger explosion. How many of you in here remember seeing that when you were in school during your formative years? Yeah, I don't know if you remember our teacher wielding the TV. You know, we all got together in one room, we're all sitting on the floor, and there was such excitement because there was a teacher on board, Krista McAuliffe, and there was a teacher in space, and we were so excited for that. And within moments of takeoff, it explodes live on TV. And it wasn't about excitement and pride and patriotism at that point. It was about skepticism and doubt and sadness and watching your teachers cry. And for us, there was no one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. It was Reagan addressing the nation, kind of consoling the nation. My point is this. You're looking at the same institution, but depending on your generational vantage point, you remember it, you experience it, and you were impacted by it very differently. Led one generation down a path of optimism and can-do-ness, another down a path of skepticism. That's how impactful all of these different events can be on shaping who we are. We don't have a lot of time to go into it today, but if you want to take a deep dive into each generation's formative years, look at the events, the conditions, and the lasting impact, feel free to text generations to 66866. We have a whole Generations 101 booklet we'll send you. So if you're kind of a gen junkie like I am and you want to take a deep dive, feel free to do that. But at the end of the day, the biggest deterrent when we're getting to know one another and we're getting to know other generations is that we stereotype. And every single generation has had to contend with stereotypes. Boomers had to do it. I know Xers, we had to do it. Remember, they used to call us the slackers. It's very original. But today, if we're being honest, which generation is under the microscope? Who's in the hot seat right now when it comes to stereotypes? Millennials. And millennials, you guys have what I would call a bit of a branding issue going on right now. I mean, think about it. If I were to ask you to describe millennials in one word, you'd start shouting things at me like entitled, lazy, no work ethic. And I always have to remind people, they can hear you. Just so you know that. They can hear you. It's weird. When you think about diversity in the workplace, generation seems to be the only area where we all feel emboldened just to say whatever we want, and there are no repercussions. When in fact, there are. Millennials at this point have a bit of millennial fatigue because they're tired of being associated with something that is so profoundly negative, and you can hardly blame them. I do interviews all the time with people of all different generations and millennials over the last few years try and create quite a bit of distance between themselves and that name. You know, I'm a millennial, but, you know, I work hard and I show up on time. They have to qualify it somehow. I'm a millennial, but, you know, I don't really believe in labels, so I don't like that. Or I'm a millennial, but, you know, I'm an older millennial, so you can just call me an Xer and we're good. We have a whole generation of young people who are trying to distance themselves from this word rather than have generational pride that goes along with it. So the question becomes, as leaders, how do we look past the stereotypes and get to the heart of who this generation is and what they're looking for? Because right now, 10,000 baby boomers are turning 65 every single day in the United States. There's a generational demographic shift that's happening right now. And millennials aren't just kids anymore. The oldest millennials are in their mid-30s, and millennials held 20% of all leadership roles in 2017. There's a big difference between a 24-year-old and a 36-year-old. And millennials, to you I say this, if we don't like what's being said, what are we doing to change the conversation? And that's what I want to take a bit of a deeper dive into. Some of you in here were nice enough to take a survey that I sent out. I really wanted to take everyone's temperature and figure out where the biggest generational struggles were. The number one thing that got brought up, work ethic. I want to talk a little bit about that, work ethic. It's so interesting because we talk about work ethic all the time, and a lot of people will say, oh, this younger generation, they don't have any work ethic, and we used to work hard, and they don't work hard, and we talk about working hard, and then it gets to the point where you can't help but wonder, what are we talking about? When we say hard work, what does that mean? How do you define it? What does it look like? What does hard work actually mean to you? I know for baby boomers, hard work was simple. This is a generation of 80 million when they reached their peak. When they got to the workplace, they had to find ways to stand out from the crowd. And their bosses were traditionalists, so they knew in order to do that, they had to be the first ones in the morning, and they wouldn't leave until the boss left at the end of the day. It was about face time. The longer you're here, the harder you're working. It was baby boomers who turned our average 40-hour work week into the 50, 60, 70-hour work week. Thank you, boomers, for that, by the way. But they knew if they didn't, there'd be somebody in line behind them who would. So for them, it was all about sacrifice. You have life and you have work. And you sacrifice life for work if need be. Then enter Gen X. We were the generation that sort of introduced the concept of work-life balance. We were coming up during a time when we saw more and more innovations with technology. And the mindset became, If we were more efficient, could we find a way to have a bit more balance in our lives so we didn't have to sacrifice everything our parents sacrificed for us? Now enter millennials. A lot of people think it's all about work-life balance, but really, the millennials I talk to across the country, I find it's something completely different than that. It's not just about flexibility, it's about, really, it's work-life integration. Work and life, it's two sides of the same coin anymore. It's two sides of the same coin now, because for this generation, you're not one person at home and one person at work. It's all the same. And we found with this generation, it's one that really values relationships, family, friendships, and experiences just as much as their career. For this generation, it's not about career and everything else. It's everything else with their career and finding ways that they can balance it. And it's interesting because right now, you're in a profession where burnout is an issue. It is a huge issue. And it's interesting, some of the responses I got from the survey, because baby boomers, when asked about people entering the workplace now, younger people who they work with, students, the biggest criticism was this lack of work ethic, this shift mentality, that as soon as the shift's over, you're on to the next, and you don't necessarily want to stay and work longer or put in more hours. That commitment, that time factor isn't there. And then when boomers and Xers were asked, well, where could your generation improve? Well, we really need to balance work and life a little bit better. We need to get better at finding that balance. So it's interesting. We all know it's important. We all know burnout's an issue, but how are we going about approaching it? A few strategies, just a few takeaways when it comes to working across generations, when it comes to how work ethic is perceived. For all of you in here who work with boomers, if you want to get on their good side, if you want to stand out from the crowd, be willing to go the extra mile. Show respect by putting in the time. This is a generation that still sees the value in that. And they're not going to give you a hug every time you do it, but they're paying attention. And they notice who's willing to do it and who's not. Because for them, that sacrifice was standard. It was expected. So when they see other people do it, it goes a long way. For Xers, we're a generation where efficiency is key. We have the mindset of let's use our time wisely. So for us, whether it's a meeting or a procedure, we want everything to run as efficient as possible. And for millennials, this is a generation that's looking for those opportunities for flexibility. So I know it's hard with what you do, but try and find those opportunities and highlight those that are already in place. Let this generation know from day one, there is sacrifice, there is hard work, there is long hours, there is stress, but we recognize that and we're looking for ways for you to find a way to alleviate that burnout and have that work-life integration. Because this is something, whatever industry, whatever profession, whatever career it is, millennials are looking for that. So try and help them find that and help them create and strike that balance. 77% of millennials believe that a flexible schedule or some kind of a flexibility would help make them more productive when they're actually at work. Another thing that came up, feedback. You know, as a room that has a lot of educators and potential educators in the room, feedback is so crucial because as mentors, we want to make sure that we are imparting wisdom and giving feedback in a way that it's being heard and understood and improvement can happen. The problem with feedback is this. We tend to give feedback the way we would want to receive it. And what we have found over the years is that that doesn't always work across generations. In a recent survey, we asked millennials and Gen Z, what do you value most from a leader or a boss? And the number one answer, we did three segments. We did older millennial, younger millennial, and Gen Z. All three segments cited encouragement, hands down, the number one thing they're looking for from a leader. What is encouragement? Would you describe your leadership style as encouraging? A handful of you did on the survey that I sent out, and a handful of you didn't. So I want to talk a little bit about that and why that encouragement is so important. For us Xers, we're that generation of latchkey kids. We grew up in homes where we often had to fend for ourselves. Mom or dad didn't know where we were or what we were doing half the time. We were responsible for our own time, and we developed a very direct and to-the-point style of communication. We're pretty blunt when it comes to how we communicate. Some people have called us a little mean, which I think is a bit aggressive, but Xers don't sugarcoat things. And when it comes to feedback, it's where we can get ourselves into trouble sometimes. 80% of millennials are looking for feedback in real time. The idea of a quarterly or annual review has its place when it comes to HR and what have you, but millennials are looking for frequent check-ins. You ask your average Gen Xer what they think about that, and they use words like needy and coddled, when in fact, is that a guilty chuckle that I'm hearing, Xers? When in fact, I will tell you, millennials say, look, for us it just makes sense. If I'm not doing something right, if what I'm doing isn't up to scratch, tell me now. Don't wait for 5.5 months and then tell me so I can listen to a laundry list of things that I've been doing wrong. When asked in a recent survey why most millennials were asked, what was the number one moment when you decided to leave your current role? The number one answer on the survey, my first review session. They walk in thinking it's gonna go one way, and then imagine, I mean, you sit down, you're all excited, and sitting across from you is some grouchy, no-nonsense, tell-it-like-it-is Xer who starts giving you more direct feedback than you've ever received in your entire life in one sitting. Are you gonna motivate them, or are you gonna scare the hell out of them? You gotta keep in mind, for some of these people, you might be the first one to give them that kind of feedback and criticism. Our goal at the end of the day is to get people to improve and wanna do better. And so, some strategies moving forward. Deliver feedback in real time. So much of this generation's formative years, everything happened in real time. You send a text, you post something on social media, you get feedback on that in real time. Everything's been happening in real time. You could check your grades in real time. I remember pestering my teacher. I'm like, report cards are coming out. Where am I at? And you know, they'd have to check the grade book. Students over the last 10 years can go online and see exactly where they are at all times. Feedback was always given to them in real time. So find those opportunities to let them know in the moment how things are going. Be specific and offer a roadmap for improvement. That's what they're looking for. With your years of knowledge, they're looking for that. Sometimes you think, no, they're not. They are. They're looking for those opportunities to learn and to be mentored. So don't just tell them what's wrong, show them how to make it right. And lastly, don't forget to focus on the positive. I think so often we equate feedback with negative. Feedback's a bad thing, it's a negative thing, it's about improvement. When things are running status quo and going as they should, we don't think to pull people aside and say, you're doing an awesome job. Find those opportunities to do that. Change the perception of feedback from being this negative thing to something that's good. Another thing that got brought up, and it's the last thing I want to talk with you about, communication. Getting on the same page, how we communicate with patients, colleagues, instructors. Sometimes it feels like we're not on the same page. What's funny about this is that I do this for a living. I speak on generations, and I find myself having communication clashes all the time. And I wanna share one with you now because it's too funny. This happened a little over a year ago. It was with a millennial colleague of mine. Now, millennials came up communicating much differently than my generation did as a Gen Xer. This is a text exchange my millennial colleague and I had. About a year ago, she came to watch me give a speech with our summer intern. And the morning of the speech, I got this text. Hannah wrote to me, yo, she's a millennial, just keep in mind. Yo, we stupidly got up for 6 a.m. breakfast and the restaurant is closed. We were thinking of heading out now to find a Starbucks and then just meeting you at the Hilton. Is that cool? Want us to get you anything? I replied. I said, that's cool. No need to pick me up anything. I think they will have stuff at the meeting. Thanks. Hannah replied to that. Alrighty. Let me know if you change your mind. Excited to see you present today. Kill it. Strong arm emoji. I think I wrote something like, sounds good, and off I went. I do the speech. Afterwards, I'm chatting with her. I thank her for coming. When the intern walked away, she kind of leaned into me, and she goes, so, are we cool? And I said, yeah, we're cool. Why? She goes, well, I got the impression this morning you were kind of upset with me. And I said, what would give you that impression? I've never been upset with her once in my life. You want to know what gave her that impression? This exchange right here. Ladies and gentlemen, please tell me, why did my millennial colleague assume I was upset with her? Yeah. Well, one, I'm hearing the word period a lot, and you are correct. I used periods. 4 of them. You know what the nail in the coffin was? Thanks. She's thinking between that and the fact that I'm not using exclamation points and there's no emojis, that I'm coming off curt and short and kind of annoyed. I was thinking grammar is the only thing that crossed my mind. And we had to laugh because we're sitting there going, oh my gosh, they pay us to go out and talk about this, and here we are having this conversation right now. It made me realize no one is immune to this. And what's funny is I found myself in a position that I tell people about all the time. You've got one of two choices. You can either A, dig your heels in and say, the way I text is fine, so deal with it. Or B, I can listen to what she says to me and think about what I can do different moving forward. And Hannah did the same thing. If she were up here right now, she'd be talking about how she needs to keep in mind that people who use periods aren't screaming at her. That's not what they're designed for. And I needed to realize too that I'm a grown man. If I don't want to use emojis and exclamation points, I certainly don't have to. But she said that I wasn't coming across like myself. Like how I am in person wasn't sort of coming across in the text. And I don't want that to be the case. So I'm a little more thoughtful about that moving forward. At the end of the day, it's so funny to me how our communication preferences are stemmed from our formative years. Baby boomers, if you wanted to communicate with somebody who wasn't physically there with you, what device would you have to use? You use the telephone. That is a rotary dial phone, by the way. Boomers, you didn't realize it at the time, but that thing taught you a lot. It taught you manners, small talk, greetings, salutations. Because when you called somebody, chances are whoever you were calling, you couldn't reach them directly. There was usually a gatekeeper, a mom, a dad, a sibling, a grandparent, that you had to make small talk with, you had to speak to. Is so-and-so there? When will they be back? Please tell them I called. Thank you so much. Not only that, boomers, you were little appointment setters before you ever started your career. Somebody was going to call you at 5 o'clock. Where did you need to be at 5 o'clock? By the phone. You went to the phone. The phone didn't come with you. That was the big difference. Xers, we remember all of that too, but we started to see some innovations that were designed to make communication a bit more efficient, my favorite of which being this. Good old-fashioned beeper. But again, answering machines, beepers, these things that were designed to make communication more efficient. And let me tell you something. If you are a precocious child who now gets paid to talk, I used to get cut off by many answering machines. This is not voicemail, by the way. This is an actual cassette in a machine that only had so much time per message. So if I started monologuing too much, it would cut me off. I didn't like that. So I learned to get to the point. I learned that I need to land the plane. I can't keep circling around. I gotta get to the point. And a lot of Xers learned that lesson growing up. Now cut to millennials. You're a generation that is now using devices other than the telephone to communicate with friends. Show of hands, millennials, how many of you use AOL chat when you were young? Oh yeah. Do you remember your screen name? I'm guessing it was something ridiculous. They usually were. But it's a generation that was starting to communicate more via text, via chat, via IM. We found the back and forth a bit more casual and short, and we were now having direct connections with our friends without that gatekeeper. Now cut to today. You have 13-year-olds who have mini computers in their pocket at all times. I mean, we call it a cell phone, but let's be real. What's the last thing we use it for now? Yes, actually picking up the phone and talking. My question is this. If you're a generation who grows up doing this more than this, is that going to impact your soft skills and your interpersonal skills? It absolutely is. So some communication tips for you when you think about working across generations with boomers, your colleagues, patients, don't skimp on those formalities and pleasantries, the good mornings. Those things go a long way. How are you? How was your weekend? Having those face-to-face conversations, so important to this generation. Xers, again, direct, transparent, and efficient. Next time you're in a meeting that you think might be going a little too long, look around the room and look at the face of the Xers in the room, and chances are it's going to read something like, we could have just done this over email. I don't know what the heck we're doing in here. Millennials often prefer that instantaneous communication. And not only that, casual and authentic. That goes a long way with this generation. They were always told to bring your whole self to the table. So it's not work them and life them. It's all, again, the same thing. So whether it's a colleague, a subordinate, a patient, having that authenticity in how you communicate is going to go a long way. And you could see it in that text exchange I had with Hannah. But with Gen Z, really quick before we say goodbye, one thing I want to point out, a lot of different industries, a lot of different professions right now are finding that soft skill training is going a long way because this is a muscle for them that hasn't been stretched. And you're gonna notice this in the coming years as more and more young, talented people are coming through that door who came up communicating in an entirely different way. Finding those opportunities to really stretch those muscles and train them on those soft skills, things that I'm sure boomers are like, well, that would have been ridiculous for us to get trained on that when we were at that stage in our career. True. But how you communicated looked a lot different. This is now a generation that's been communicating primarily with their cohorts. Now they're going to be working with different generations of colleagues and patients, and they're going to need to really learn those soft skills. Really quick, I talked to a dental instructor out of the Twin Cities who had said to me that he noticed that with his students, that during any kind of practical, they were great working with patients. They knew what they were doing. They knew the procedures. They knew it all. But they wouldn't talk to them. And he thought, man, it doesn't matter how great or gifted they are. I don't know how successful they'll be down the road in their own practice if they're creeping everyone out because they're not talking. So he started to make a rule. The beginning of his classes where patients came in, he made a rule. No phones, no instruments, no work for 5 minutes. He wanted 5 minutes of conversation between the students and the patients. Sit down next to them, 5 minutes. I don't care what you talk about. How long is 5 minutes if you are somebody who struggles with face-to-face communication? Yeah, they didn't love it. But he said he noticed significant improvement by the end of the first semester. By the time that first class had graduated, people were coming up to him and saying, thank you. I didn't love it, but I'm glad you made us do it. He saw that that was a muscle that needed to be stretched, and he found a way to stretch it. And so that's something I encourage all of you to do as we move forward. If you want more information on Gen Z and some of the trends we're noticing, by all means, please reach out to us. Our website is generations.com. Again, for more information, text generations to 66866 if you want to take a deep dive into formative years. But I just want to leave it with this. At the end of the day, every single generation you work with is bringing something different, valuable, and important to the table. And it's not about right or wrong or better or worse. It's about understanding where these differences come from and how we can embrace them and how we ourselves can help bridge those generational gaps. So with that, folks, thank you so much for having me here this morning. I really appreciate it. Enjoy the rest of the day. Yes. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Perfect.
Thanks.
Thank you, Scott. Thanks to all y'all for joining us, and enjoy the rest of this fabulous meeting. Thank y'all.